Help support AMTV by becoming a patron, an AMTV staff member, and following us over on Twitter. Hi there, guys. It's Adam Martyn here, and today we're going to talk about EastEnders. The show itself has not been cancelled. There's no confirmation. I don't think there's any even rumours that this is happening. The show is safe, so if you're a fan, please don't bite my head off. This is purely like a speculation thing and just, you know, an opinion piece, as a lot of these videos are. So don't worry, the show's sticking around. So why do I think EastEnders should come to an end? Well, again, I'm not really a fan of EastEnders. I've never really watched it in my lifetime. I've always sort of been aware of it. You know, it's something my parents used to watch like every week, all the episodes that it was on. And I'd say they did that from, well, I think they did it before I was born, because, you know, EastEnders has been going since 1985. But from my memory, I'd say they watched EastEnders pretty religiously from the year 2000 all the way up until, say, 2020, maybe even 2021, you know, around the pandemic time. So that's 20 years. And indeed, EastEnders, I won't deny, has been very popular. I'm not saying it's a dead show by any means. I mean, it's really captivated the hearts and minds of people. I mean, just looking at this ratings table here for EastEnders, the first series back in 1985 had an average of 14 million viewers, over 14 million viewers. And again, you might tout that down to several reasons. You know, back then, there was only four main channels people had access to. Satellite television did exist, but it was mainly only accessible at that point, you know, the mid-80s, by those who had a lot of money, those who could afford the dishes, etc. So there was definitely less choice, but you can see its popularity grew, arguably reached an apex on a viewer average in 1986-87. But even throughout the rest of the 80s and throughout the 90s, like even up until the year 2000, as you can see here, it holds an average of around, you know, at least 15 million viewers, which isn't to be 14, 15 million, that isn't to be snubbed at all, particularly by the time we reach the new millennium, when there's a lot more channels that are a lot more easily accessible. The fact that EastEnders was still able to maintain that high audience is pretty impressive for a soap opera, I'm not gonna lie. And then as you can see, as we get into the 21st century, those numbers generally start to come down. There's a big dip here between 2001-2002. The series average drops by nearly 4 million viewers there, and it continues to decrease. The first series where it doesn't maintain over a 10 million average came in 2006, where the average was 9.16 million there, and it continues to drop and drop and drop. And now the big shift, I think you might... Well, not necessarily the big shift, but you can see in 2020, the pandemic year, when there was 138 episodes, which for EastEnders, by the way, is comparatively low. That was an average of 5.49, and in 2021 it dropped again to an average of 4.36. Now, some would instantly say that's EastEnders dead in the water. Anyone who has any understanding of current television knows for a soap opera to average 4 million viewers these days is not particularly a bad showing, you know, considering the amount of competition that there is and how viewing habits have changed as well. Now you've got streaming, you've got catch up, a lot of people are consuming it that way, so things have definitely changed a lot. But I will, you know, I think it's all right to admit that the drop in viewership has happened. You know, this has definitely occurred over time. Like with any long-running program, you know, it's been going for nearly 40 years. Maybe some people who watch just aren't a fan of the current storylines. They maybe aren't necessarily getting new blood, like new fans into the show. And this leads me to one of my main points as to why I think EastEnders should end. In my opinion, I don't think it's capturing like the new generations, and that's for a few reasons, one of which is viewing habits have changed. A lot of people my age, you know, I'm in my mid-20s, but a lot of people younger than me or like around my age, they consume any sort of TV now on streaming, and they might decide to binge watch it, you know, like certain Netflix shows where they drop all their episodes at once. They like to do that. The notion of a soap opera, I don't know many people my age bracket who still watch soap operas dedicated week in, week out. And again, like, what new soap operas themselves are being commissioned? I mean, in the same style as EastEnders, you know, multiple episodes a week running all year round. I think the practice is not necessarily tired, but I don't think it necessarily has as much power and pull in the current TV landscape as it did 10, 20, 30 years ago. Because again, you know, EastEnders, they make episodes all year round. They can't just, even though it's split into seasons, you know, there are seasons or series of EastEnders, if you like, but they aren't being, you know, dumped all at once. You can't dump 200 episodes at once. That's just not viable. So they have to air it, you know, the multiple episodes a week or whatever. I did hear a thing that weren't they testing, like, putting a week's worth of episodes on the iPlayer in advance or something like that? I'm not sure if that's true. You might have to let me know if that's the case. But I think the EastEnders model, the model that it's operated on since its inception back in 1985, I don't think necessarily gels with the current generations anymore. And I think it may be as well that because it's so old, you know, 38 years, which is old in television, there might be a public perception, and again, this is just theory, I'm not saying this is true, but there might be a public perception that EastEnders as a brand, you know, is old, something the older generations watch. And as cynical as it is to say, because there's a lot of young people who enjoy all the programmes, but there are some audiences out there who, if they get that perception that this is like their mum or dad's programme or an older programme, they won't want to tune in. And I think really another reason why it should end, and I'm coming to the other soaps as well, they don't get off the hook just like that. I think, you know, over 38 years, how many storylines can you really run out? How many murders can there be? How many kidnappings? How many disappearances? You know, because soap operas ultimately, especially ones like this, yes, they are sensationalized because that's what gets viewership. But really, I think they need to keep that one foot in reality, because that's what people always liked about soap operas. It was the fact that they were somewhat relatable, you know, trying to show everyday people, etc. But I've heard some reports that some say EastEnders has gone way off the wall for this, and it just comes across as tired and not very fresh anymore. And, you know, the other soaps you could argue are guilty of this as well. I mean, Coronation Street has been going for over 60 years. Let me just say that again, over 60 years, and people still seem to really enjoy that. They haven't seemed to have got tired of Corrie. Emmerdale recently celebrated its 50th anniversary as well, so there's a lot to be said on that there. I actually did a poll on my community tab, which you can go and see there, and nearly 900 of you voted. Bear in mind, I put this out late last night, so... But at the time I'm recording this, 60% of people, I asked the question, which of the three, like the big three UK soap operas should end next? And 60% of those votes went for EastEnders. Corrie, the oldest show, interestingly, got the least amount of votes, and then followed by Emmerdale. So clearly there is some semblance, at least in my viewership or people who watch, who think EastEnders should end too. However, I guess some would say that there is still life in the old dog yet. There's an article here that I found from Wales Online that says BBC EastEnders fans all say the same thing as a 10-month cliffhanger airs in show first. It says EastEnders celebrated its 38th anniversary with a female-led episode on Monday, January 20th. The special, which was billed as a life-altering event, ended with the shock death of a mystery character in a flash-forward scene, the first in the BBC soap opera's history. So it shows various characters toasting the men who have wronged them. The scene then cut to black and faded into a flash-forward scene that takes place at Christmas this year. So the boss of the show at the minute, Chris Clenshaw, said, "We were looking for a vehicle for the six women involved, so Linda, Suki, Kathy, Stacey, Denise and Sharon, to come together, and we were looking for an episode to get viewers really excited, or maybe get them to switch on, as we set up an event that they'll hopefully look forward to all year." So a flash forward, and you know, it seemed to get people talking, people excited, and you know, it's a first, considering the show's nearly 40 years old, for it to still have first, you know, that's fairly impressive if you ask me, you know, kudos to them for that. But, you know, again, with things like this, how long is that going to last? And I just want to say as well, I'm in no way slagging off the creative talent and effort that goes behind making this show. You know, as an actor and creative myself, this involves a lot of time, a lot of hours, a lot of money involved as well in getting this on the road. And I absolutely commend them, particularly during the height of the pandemic, getting this thing on the air and still getting it on the air. It's a well-oiled machine. But, you know, again, this is just raising the question that it's not so much the effort behind it, but it's... Has the show itself just become a bit tired? Now, there may be argument that it's never going to go away in the near future, because I know the BBC recently invested in either revamping the EastEnders set or installing like a new EastEnders set. That would have been a big investment, you know, definitely for the near long haul. We are approaching the 40th anniversary of EastEnders, of course, which will happen in 2025. I've seen some comments suggest that that would be a good time for the show to bow out, but considering that's only 2 years away... Again, with that investment, my guess is they've got a few more years left in them yet, at least either contractually or financially in terms of what's been invested. In terms of what you can consume of EastEnders, because of course it's a near 40-year-old show, there's a lot of history, it's a bit scattered. So on the iPlayer, there is the regular EastEnders page there where I believe it has like the last year's worth of episodes. So if you've missed anything in the last year, then you can definitely check that out. Then we get some odd ones. There's EastEnders iconic episodes, which, you know, is exactly as it suggests. It's iconic episodes from the show. There's a selection there. So you've got Den and Angie, you've got Colin and the Guido, their kiss, Sharon Gate, Pat and Peggy. You know, a lot of things I'm sure you EastEnders fans will know a lot more about than me. But then you have EastEnders 2008 to 2011, which is a wonderfully specific time frame. And I believe it is just that. There's 568 episodes available, which is... that's a lot of episodes. I don't think that is every single episode from 2008 to 2011, because just looking at the numbers, that would equate to, say, at least over 800 episodes, and there's only 568. So again, I'm not an EastEnders fan. I don't know which episodes have been included, which haven't been included, so you might have to double check, do some research. But hey, if 2008 to 11 was a golden era for the show and that's why it's here, then you can check that out. But there's no other eras like that. You know, there's none of the stretching from the 80s or 90s. So it seems an odd choice. On BritBox, however, if you subscribe to BritBox, or I guess ITVX, you get your BritBox subscription. They have a selection of iconic episodes as well. Some of them are similar to the iPlayer, like I think, again, I don't know my EastEnders lore all that too well, but you've got the Den and Angie episode from October of 1986. I believe that was a very big story, a very big storyline at the time. The record-breaking Christmas special from that year as well, which, if I'm not mistaken, got the highest ratings for EastEnders ever, would you believe, which peaked at 30.15 million. 30 million, let that sink in. That's either nearly or around half of the country tuned in to watch this stuff. So yeah, EastEnders was big business, and some would say still is. So just to summarize, why do I think EastEnders should end? I think it does feel a bit tired. I think that the amount of storylines have been exhausted to a point, but you could aim that at the other shows as well. But I think more importantly, it's the generational thing. As far as I know, you know, or from like the people I chat with, my friends and stuff like that, or just the general consensus, I don't think EastEnders is being consumed by the new generations of young adults, you know, people in their early 20s or even teenagers or anything like that. I think it's viewed as a bit of an old brand, a bit of an old program, something like your parents watch or even your grandparents in some cases. So it's a shame, really, because I'm sure there is a lot of, you know, it's been lauded for really positive storylines, either like groundbreaking stuff, very hard-hitting stuff that's done well to raise awareness. But I just think it's time for the residents of the East End on Albert Square to bow out, to call it a day. But let me know what you think about this. Do you think EastEnders should bite the dust, or do you think there's still a lot of life in the old dog yet and it should keep on going? Or, alternatively, do you think another one of the main soap operas here in the UK should wind up? Let me know what you think about this situation in the comments down below. If you enjoyed this video as well, please leave a like on it. We really do appreciate it. It helps us out a lot. And subscribe here at AMTV and the AMTV network as a whole. We've got two other channels, one focused on Now That's What I Call Music and just general music-related content. And we've got AMTV Who, which is all about Doctor Who. So if that's your thing, head over there. But until the next one, I've been Adam Martyn from AMTV. Thank you for joining me, and I'll see you next time. Thank you to our patrons for helping to support the show, and a special thank you to Macra, Hooks Media, Ben Freeman, Ethan Carberry-Holt, The Broken Kitsumanoid, Globe of Reviews, Derek Chambers, Sean Nock, Dord Khan, and Fabina UPC V2.0, our AMTV staff members.